Hello, I'm Julie Andrews, and this is Homework, a memoir of my Hollywood years, co-written with Emma Walton Hamilton. For my grandchildren, with love. I know that I am all that I am, and all that I am is full and ripe. All that I am is standing still, waiting and watching and bursting with life, holding the straining seams of my skin, my passion and wit and my sanity in, waiting for someone to soothe and to say, I understand. You're home. Introduction. In my first memoir, entitled Home, I wrote about my youth, growing up during World War II, and my experiences performing in vaudeville from ages 10 to 18, and on Broadway in my early 20s. I wanted to share what it was like in those days, living through the Blitz, touring endlessly around England, singing in the old music halls, trying desperately to learn my craft and feel at home in spite of my transience. Only when I became moderately successful on Broadway did I dare to trust that I'd never have to go back to the bleak existence of those early days. In this new memoir, I describe my years working in Hollywood, beginning with the filming of Mary Poppins. For those who did not read my first book or who might like a reminder of what led to this next chapter in my life, I offer the following recap. I was born in Walton-on-Thames, a small suburban village in the county of Surrey, just 18 miles southwest of London. My mother's father was a coal miner, and her mother was a chambermaid. My mother, Barbara Morris, was just 18 when her parents died within a year of each other. Her aspirations to become a classical pianist were cut short by the fact that she was now the primary caregiver to her 13-year-old sister, Joan. It wasn't long before the girls met my father, Ted Wells, an impoverished teacher. He fell madly in love with my red-haired, vivacious mother and offered stability for both sisters, despite his economic status. When my parents married, they moved with my aunt to a small cottage, which they called Threesome. My mother gave piano lessons, and my aunt taught dance to augment my father's wages. My father was the family's rock. My brother John was born 2 years after me, and Dad showed us the wonders of nature, trees, seasons, wildlife. Dad adored rivers and lakes and often took us rowing on the Thames. He wasn't physically demonstrative, but there was never any doubt as to his love for and dedication to us. In the summer of 1939, when I was not quite 4 years old, my mother was playing at a series of concerts in a coastal town. She provided piano accompaniment to a Canadian tenor by the name of Ted Andrews. They began to tour together, and just before the start of World War II, my mother left my father and moved, with Ted Andrews, to London. Shortly thereafter, she sent for me to come and live with them, while Johnny remained with our dad. The time in London was a radical awakening for me. The city was filthy with soot and grey with fog, and I was unsettled by this new man in my mother's life. He was large, loud, and volatile, and as ill at ease with me as I was with him. My basement room in our apartment was hot and sterile, with bars on the windows. At night, rats ran across the exposed pipes. Air raid sirens wailed often, and we were required to employ blackout curtains and keep all lights off after dark. Bombing raids became a regular occurrence, and we were frequently forced to retreat to the underground subway stations for shelter. After my mother moved away, my Aunt Joan married her boyfriend, Bill Wilby. Because of the war effort, my dad had been assigned to work in a converted factory, making parts for Spitfire aircraft, and there he met a young widow named Winifred. By this time, Mum was pregnant with my half-brother, Donald, and not long thereafter, she married Ted Andrews, and Dad married Win. Mum and Ted decided that my name should be changed from Julia Wells to Julie Andrews, and that I should call my new stepfather Pop, presumably to make us feel more like a family. In the spring of 1943, Mum, Pop, Donald and I moved out of London to a suburban part of Kent. Pop began giving me singing lessons, perhaps in an attempt to bond with his new stepdaughter, perhaps to give me something to do since my school had shut down briefly due to the escalation of the war. I disliked these lessons intensely. I was shy and embarrassed, but Mum and Pop were surprised to discover that I had a strong soprano voice, quite unique for my age. Our new home in Kent had an air raid shelter in the garden, and as the war continued, we often spent nights out there. By mid-1944, the Germans were sending doodlebugs to England. These were pilotless flying bombs that came across the English Channel, cut out over their target, and plummeted to earth. I could tell the difference between the sound of these doodlebugs approaching and our own fighter planes. The air raid sirens became so constant that they prevented families from accomplishing the most basic of tasks, making dinner, doing the laundry. My mother came up with the idea that I should sit on top of the air raid shelter with a pair of opera glasses and a whistle. Whenever I heard a doodlebug approaching, I would blow the whistle, giving my mother, and as it turned out, many other neighborhood homemakers, time to finish a chore before running to take shelter. I was on duty in all weathers. One rainy day, I rebelled and stayed in the house. After the bomb dropped, several neighbors came to the door, demanding, "Why the hell didn't she blow her whistle?" My dad, Win, and Johnny moved to Chessington, about an hour away from us. I visited when I could, which was not often. Returning home from those visits was always emotionally painful. By age 9 and a half, my singing voice had improved so much that I began taking lessons with Pop's voice teacher, Madam Lillian Stiles Allen. Madam, an esteemed dramatic soprano, was short and stout, with a kindly nature. She was a phenomenal teacher with whom I studied for many years. She provided me with a solid technical foundation that carried me through the decades that followed. Soon after the war ended in 1945, I began to travel with Mum and Pop as they toured in vaudeville. I was struck by the contrast between the glamorous appearance of life in the theatre and the rather shabby reality of it backstage. Just before my 10th birthday, Mum and Pop invited me to join them on stage during one of their performances. I stood on a beer crate in order to reach the microphone and sang a duet with Pop while Mum accompanied us at the piano. Little by little, I began to join their act more often. Back at school, I struggled to find my place socially. Ever aware of my bandy legs, buck teeth, and lazy eye, along with my ineptitude at sports. On Saturday mornings, whenever possible, I escaped into programs for children at the local cinema. It was my first introduction to the magic of Hollywood. One day, just before Christmas of 1946, I was collected early from school. My mother told me that we were to perform for the troops that night at the stage door canteen in London. When Mum, Pop, and I arrived at the venue, I learned that Queen Elizabeth, wife of King George VI, would be in attendance. After my parents performed the bulk of their act, I was introduced and sang my duet with Pop and then a solo aria. At age 11, I was the only child in the program. Her Majesty came backstage to greet the performers. When she approached me, I curtsied, and she said, "You sang beautifully tonight." I was amazed that she took the time to compliment me. At school the next day, I found myself the center of attention. Mum, Pop, and I began touring more extensively around the country. My dad and Wynne had welcomed a baby girl, my half-sister Celia, nicknamed Shad, into the family, and the following spring my mother gave birth to my youngest half-brother, Christopher. My mother had long wanted to return to her hometown of Walton-on-Thames, and she and Pop found and purchased, with a sizable mortgage and a down payment that took almost every penny they had, a house called the Old Mers. It was a major step up for us. Originally, it had been the servants' quarters to a mansion next door. Mum discovered that her mother had been a below-stairs maid there in her teens and had actually lived in our house at that time. It was meant that we should be here, my mother said. The best thing about the Old Mers was the large...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.